Hello everyone, today we are going to see how to write recursive function for Fibonacci number computation in Python. So first we will see what do you mean by Fibonacci number series, then we will see what are all the two conditions that need to be satisfied by a problem to transform that problem into a recursive function, and then we will write recursive function for Fibonacci number series. So what is Fibonacci number series? See, this is what Fibonacci number series. Any number in the series can be derived from the previous two numbers. Say if I want to find 8, that is the number in position 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. If I want to find the 7th number in the Fibonacci series, that is nothing but the summation of last two numbers, that is 6 and 5, 6th number and 5th number, that is 3 plus 5 is 8. So this is the characteristics of Fibonacci number series, that is any number in the series can be derived from the previous two numbers. With this understanding, we will see how this problem can be transformed into recursive function. So let me write the Fibonacci. In the Fibonacci series, the first number is nothing but 0. The second number is 1. The third number is nothing but summation of second and first number. That is what given here. So we have to find the base case and recursive formula. What is base case? Given a problem, you break down the problem into sub problem until you cannot break down the particular problem. That is your base case. In the series, see, you need at least two numbers, minimum two numbers to get the third number. So the first two number in the series will be considered as your base case. The next thing is how to find the recursive formula. The way of breakdowning your original problem into sub problems of smaller size, you call it as recursive formula. See, with this understanding, that is any number can be derived from the previous two number, we are going to write the recursive formula. That is nth number in the series can be derived from the previous two number n minus 1 and n minus 2. Summation of n minus 1 and n minus 2 will give us the nth number. Okay, with this understanding, we will write recursive function for Fibonacci series. So we have transformed as such. Let me name the function name as fib, and the position, that is the number in the series, be n. Now first we write it for the base case. If n is equal to 1, then I have to return 0 because 0 is the value. If n is equal to 2, I have to return 1. If not, what is that? That means if n value is greater than 2, what to do? If n value is greater than 2, it may be 3, 4, 6, 7, whatever may be. If it is greater than 2, I have to sum it up the previous two number, that is n minus 1 plus n minus 2. So we have transformed our understanding into a function. Now we will write a main program to call out our user defined function to generate this series. If I want to have 4 number in the series, what I have to do? First I have to call out fib of 1, then fib of 2, fib of 3 and fib of 4 to generate this 4 numbers. That is what given here. I have to start it from 1 and I have to repeat it until the value reaches 4. Then I have to print that Fibonacci number. This inbuilt function fib will give me the particular number in the series. If I am calling fib of 1, then it will return me what was the number, first position number in the series. If I am calling fib of 2, it will return me the second number in the series. So you have returned the main function. Now we will see how this function works out. Initially, I have set I value as 1. So first it will check I is less than or equal to 4. Of course, it is less than. So first I will call fib of 1. So I have to return 0. Then it will come back here. It will update I value as 2. Then it will check 2 is less than or equal to 4. Yes, it is less than. So I will call fib of 2. Now it will come over here. This condition fails because n value is 2. So it will come over here and it will return 1. Till this, it is easy for us to visualize. Now comes the third case. What if then it will come over here and it will print the value as 1. Now the I value will be updated as 3. Now when I am calling fib of 3, we know this 2 condition will not work out because now n value is 3, that is greater than 2, so it will go for else condition. So I have to call fib of n minus 1, that is I will call fib of 2, and after getting the return value I will call fib of 1. So for better understanding we will see how in a step by step. So first when I call I is equal to 1, the function will be called with n value as 1. So it will return 0 and I will get the output printed as 0. Then when I is equal to 2, I will call n value with n value as 2 and it will return 1. So the two base numbers will be printed as 0 and 1. Now when I call I is equal to 3, what happened is, when I is equal to 3, the first two base condition fails. So it go for the third if condition, that is it has to call fib of 2 plus fib of 1. So how this invocation happens means, when it's the fib of 2, right, it the function will be called, it will return 1 and the return value will be returned back to the expression, then it will see the plus symbol and it will go for fib of 1. It will invoke fib of 1 function. Then this will return the value 0. Now this expression will be computed. That is, it has already written value as 1. It has written value as 0. So 1 plus 0 is 1. So now this value will be returned to fib of 3, the original calling function in your main. And so it will get printed as 1. Right? Now it will get incremented I value, then I will become 4. From the main you pass it as 4, that is for the first time the fib function is called with the value of 4 from the main, that is in the print statement. Now this will in turn call fib of 3. This fib of 3 will call, since it is n is greater than 2, it will call fib of 2. This will return 1 to the function. Then to evaluate the expression, it will call fib of 1, which will return 0. Now 1 plus 0, it will return 1 to the fib 3 function. Now to evaluate this expression, I will call fib of 2, which is nothing but 1. This will be returned over here. On evaluating the expression 1 plus 1, it will return 2 to the main function and you will get the output printed as 2. This is how the recursive function happens. To see it, to visualize in a better manner, we will see how the execution happens step by step, right? Now, first, when I see this function definition, in the global frame, memory will allocate it for the function. Then I am going for the main function. Now, memory is allotted for I with the value as 1. Then it will check for the condition. The condition will be true. So, the next statement print will be executed, which in turn will invoke the function fib with the value as 4. This value will be copied to this function definition as 1. See, now I ask I value is 1, this condition is true and it will call fib of 1 and the n value will be copied as 1. So now this function is executing with n is equal to 1. So this condition will get true and I will return 0 to the main function. Returning value 0 to the main function. From here, the value will be returned over here as 0. So I have to get it printed as 0. Yes, it is printed. Now, as the function is being executed, the scope ends up. The memory for this, but allotted for this function instance, execution instance is removed. Now, the I value is updated as 2. Right, I value is updated as 2. I check for the condition. The condition will be true. So I have to invoke the function with I value as 2. Right, the function, new function instance is created for the fib function with value of n as 2. Now the first condition will not be success because the n value is 2. So it will move for the next condition. Yes, the condition is true. So it has to return 1 to the main calling, to its calling function. So the calling function is global, that is the main function. Now, yes, it is going to return value 1 to the global frame. It has returned value 1, so it has got printed, right? Now the I value will be updated to 3. Yes, it is updated to 3. Now, 3 is less than or equal to 4. Yes, it is true. So, I will again call the function new instance of my Fibonacci series. Now, its parent is global. That is, I am calling from the main. Now, the n value is 3. The first condition will fail because n value is 3. The second condition will also fail. On the third condition, the first statement in the expression will be evaluated. That is, it will create a new instance with n value as 2 because you have passed it as 3. So, it will create a new function instance with n value as 2. Yeah, it is created with the n value as 2. Now, it is simple. The first condition is false. The second condition is true. So, it has to return 2 to the main function. Yes. It will return 1 to the main function. Now, here it has returned 1, right? But here it is not still completed the evaluation in the of expression in the return statement. So it has to again invoke the same fib function with n value as 1. Let's see. It has created a new instance with n value as 1. Now it will return 0. So already here I have return value as 1 plus now the return value is 0, 1 plus 0. Now I have to return 1 to the main calling function which will print here as 1. 0 plus 1. See, it is printed as 1. Now the I value will be updated for 4. Yes, it is updated for 4. Still the condition is true. Now I have to call this function. See, all the functions scope has ended. Now I will create a new instance of function with fib value as 4. N value as 4. See, it is here. We know this two condition will fail because we already know, we have already seen for 1 and 2. Now it will go here and it will call fib of 3 plus fib of 2. See, on execution of this particular statement, it will create a new instance for fib of 3. It has created a new instance for fib of 3. We have already seen how it will execute. Fib of 3 means again 1 and 2 condition. Then it will go over here and it will call fib of 2 plus fib of 1. Now an instance will be created for web of instance created for n is equal to 2, right? So now it has to return value as 1. See, it returns value as 1. That is, now it will be 1 plus feb of 1. We know feb of 1 is 0. So, first an instance will be created for feb of 1, n is equal to 1, and then the condition will true. It will return value as 0. Already we have 1, so 1 plus 0. It will return feb of 3 as 1. Now you have to evaluate x, a function after plus symbol. So now I have to call feb of 2. We already know it will return in a single call because we have n is equal to 2. It will return 1. See, a new instance would have been created for n is equal to 2 and it will return 1. So already we had 1, so 1 plus 1, it will return over here as 1 plus 1, it will return over here as 2, and you will get the value printed as 2. See, it is printed as 2, and now the I value will be updated as 5. Yes, it is updated as 5. So it will come out of the while loop. Since the condition will fail, it will come out of the while loop and execution ends. This is how our regression works. We will see some facts about the regression. Is there any limit on the number of regression? Yes, of course, you have restriction. It will throw regression error in Python if the regression crosses 1000 level, the nested regression. So what is the advantage of it? Even a big complex iterative solutions can be made easy and simple with regression. So what is the drawback? It is logical to understand, but it is difficult to trace and debug, and it requires extra storage space. Because for every recursive call, you need separate memory for the variables present in them. So with this, I conclude. Thank you.